ever made. X-Wing. In 2013, LEGO built a one-to-one scale model of the X-Wing fighter jet from Star Wars that is fit for any budding Jedi. The scale model was built with 5,335,200 bricks and weighs nearly 46,000 pounds. The LEGO X-Wing is 11 feet high, 43 feet long, and has a wingspan of 44 feet. What is even cooler is that the engines glow and roar just like they do in the Star Wars films. A real LEGO house. James May has always loved his Legos since he was a child, so when he grew up, he set out to build his own real Lego house in Dorking, Surrey. It took over 3.3 million Lego pieces to build the house. May had planned to sell the house, but because there were no buyers, he ended up demolishing it in 2009. Lego Nintendo DSi. Sean Kenny was the man responsible for building the Lego Nintendo DS sculpture. It took over 51,000 bricks to build the game console and is 7 feet wide. The structure was created to coincide with the new release of the DS and was on display in Rockefeller Center in New York City. It took about 200 man hours to complete it and it weighs about 250 pounds. Lego Pinball Machine. The Lego Pinball Machine was built in the Netherlands by Gerrit Bronsveld and Martin Bogarts. It was built with over 20,000 Legos and is a fully functioning pinball machine with a coin slot, music, sound effects, bumpers, and a digital display. Lego Volvo. In 2004, the builders at Legoland California decided to prank their general manager, Peter Ronchetti, by replacing his Volvo XC60 with a replica made entirely from Legos. It took over 201,000 blocks to replicate the Volvo, plus it weighed over a ton, but it wasn't a working car, so Ronchetti had to do some schmoozing to get his car back.
It is pretty wild what people will do with their spare time, or maybe they don't even have any. Like, that's just crazy, some of the stuff that they built. Last night on Facebook, I asked the church family just to kind of share what some of the coolest things that you have built with Legos. And I just want to share with you the responses that came across. There was a few of them. Carla Wagner shared that she built a Lego tower with some family members and actually had some money inside of it. They buried it deep into the ground and still have not been able to find where this Lego... I hope that it was like ones and not 20s inside of this Lego tower. But her thought process was maybe, you know, back in Randolph where she was at the time, they've since added on a garage, and maybe they built the whole garage over the top. So this Lego foundation is underneath the garage. So that's pretty cool. Carrie Scheel said that with her brother, she built some pillars. Also a full medieval town with castle and a town market and guide outposts. I mean, that's getting pretty intense. You're not just building a thing. You're building like multiple things together. Kyle Sunderland said that he built a train set back in the day. And I'm thinking, you know, you can go buy these train sets, you know, go around your trees at Christmas time, but to build a train, like, that's pretty cool. Our worship pastor, Josh, he said he built Yoda one time out of Legos, still can't find his head. I'm not sure, like, what that says. Alicia Shetler said that her and her son, they built a coffee shop, but the big bummer was it didn't serve real coffee. So, I mean... some things people build with Legos are pretty intense. And we gave you guys this challenge a couple weeks ago to build for us the best Lego church building or the best Lego house that you could. And so next week is D-Day when we bring in all the Legos, we display the creations around the auditorium. And I'm hoping that a lot of you guys participate. So don't leave me hanging out there. I mean, even if you've got this little cube of a house, at least like pretend that you're competing in the competition. And we'll give out prizes, send you on to the National Church Planters Lego Competition. I'm just kidding there, but it would be awesome. And we're going to be handing out some prizes for that, so definitely be here. We told you that you can build this as a family, so we definitely want you to do that. But our definition of family is pretty loose. So if you want to do that as your entire conglomeration of family, go for it. If you have kids that can't get along or spouses that can't get along in vision, like you can divide and conquer if you need to. Or, you know, if your idea of a family is whatever straggler you can find because you're flying solo, I mean, that's cool too. All right, so the point is to connect the bricks and to connect with somebody else. And so we want to encourage you to do that and participate. So Legos are pretty cool. They do a lot of things, but in essence, they really only do two, right? They were created to connect. And there's only two places you can connect them, on the top and on the bottom. So if you want to build anything with Legos, you have to connect them. And so kind of the carryover for you and I, what we've been discussing is that our connection on top is really God. And our connection on the bottom is connecting with other people. And it comes from a very core passage in Scripture. It's repeated a couple different times in the Gospels or the stories about Jesus. And so in Matthew chapter 22, somebody, a teacher in the law, asks Jesus like why he or how he would summarize the entire law with one command. Okay, this was meant to trip him up. This was meant to be a test. And let's just say he aced it. Like he just came out of the gate swinging. And he said, the number one thing that you need to do, which summarizes all of these commands, is to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, soul, and mind. If you go to Mark chapter 12, where it repeats this, it says, and strength. But the idea, regardless of which passage you go to, is that it's talking about a totality of our being. Like you love God with everything that you are, every thought in your head, every feeling in your body, every minute you're awake. It's all about loving God. And when we love God, then it flows naturally in our love for others. Matter of fact, we can't not love other people if we really love God. Because if we don't, we've denied God and his creation and what he loves. And so a couple weeks ago when we were talking about connecting with God, we kind of asked this question, like, what is keeping you and I from connecting with God? It seems like it's such a core fundamental piece to connect with God. If it's that all-encompassing, if it's that important, why are we failing so hard to do it? And the answer really was that the world is trying to prevent us from connecting with God. There's all sorts of stuff, distractions that are going on. But we summarized it from a passage that talked about the lust of the eyes, the things that we see, that we crave, that we covet after, the lusts of the flesh, the passions and the desires that are inside of us, and the pride of life, kind of the arrogance that exists about us. Sometimes not even wanting to ask for help or to admit that we've got things wrong. Those things definitely stand in the way of us connecting and having a true connection with God. But I think one of the most profound things that I shared was not from me, but from another pastor when he talked about, you know, you could build the best possible sailboat ever. This thing could be immaculate. You could go to the best schools and learn how to navigate with this sailboat, but if you have no wind, it's of no value. And you and I, no matter how many Bible studies we go to, no matter how many church services we attend, no matter how many community service activities we're a part of, if we're not aligning ourselves with the power of God, we've missed it. Like we're just a heap sitting there. And so you and I need to have a passionate pursuit after God and aligning ourselves with God, because from that connection, everything else flows. And then last week when we talked about connecting with other people, we talked about how it's not enough just to exist like a package of Legos. You know, you get them in the box and they just kind of rattle around. They bump edges with one another, but they never really connect. They don't really move to their true potential. And we can do the same thing. We bump shoulders with the people we work with. We bump shoulders sometimes even inside of our own homes with our family members, or even coming to a worship service like this. We come in and we're a group of separate pieces instead of a body that's joined together and connected. And so again, the world is trying to mess with us. It's trying to prevent us. Satan would love nothing more than for you and I to exist on an island by ourselves, because he can destroy us and dismantle us that way. But we learned that from the beginning in Genesis, God created us in his image. And his image is one of community. That God didn't exist as a soul entity, but God existed in three parts. That without Jesus, nothing was made that has been made. And the Spirit was there too, hovering over the surfaces of the deep. And so you and I, when we're created in the image of God, need to understand that it's not good for man to be alone, and that we should crave those connections with other people. So it can be a challenge. But I want to share with you this week what's next. So when you get Legos and you start connecting them, and sometimes we do that, sometimes we just start connecting them and try to randomly see whatever we can create. I like to do that sometimes, whether I'm drawing a picture, doodling, you know, or putting Legos together or messing with Play-Doh. Like, just start doing something and then kind of see where your imagination takes you. See what it kind of looks like. Kind of like looking for objects in the clouds, if you've ever done that. But you know what? If we're really going to accomplish the purpose of the Legos, it's to build whatever's on the box or the instruction manual kind of gives you. And so we set out on this mission to build the thing that's in there. So we connect on top and we connect on bottom because we're about to build something amazing. And maybe it's not an X-Wing fighter, but it's going to be legit. Because we're building the next church facility. And we're displaying it next week. I don't know what your scoop is there and what you're trying to accomplish. But I want to share with you the thing that we, you and I, are trying to build is actually God's church. Not a facility, but a group of people that are called out of the world to live differently. To live a life in obedience to Jesus. And we're set apart on His mission to accomplish great things. So when we connect with God and we connect with people, we actually are part of building God's church. And that's amazing. But the reality too is that if you and I aren't connected with God, we're not building His church, no matter how much we proclaim it. We can build an audience. We can develop great speeches and have some amazing worship teams. But it's not God that we're serving in the process. And that can be a struggle. And if we're not connecting with other people, and we're just like, God and I, we have this thing, we have this understanding. That's not a church. That's not community. That's not the way that we were created or designed. And I want to share with you what I think is actually a fundamental piece in building the church. Jesus says it at the end of His life here on earth. You see, He didn't just come to die. He came to live a life and give us an example. And so for 3 years of His life, He asked guys to come and follow Him. And they learned from Him. They were called disciples, students. And as they were learning about Him, He got to the end and said, you know what? All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to Me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations. We can find this in Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20. Page 542 in your Bibles if you want to follow along. If you brought your own Bible, I'm sorry, you're on your own to find that page. But if you're using one of ours, 542, Matthew chapter 28. This is referred to as the Great Commission. And this is a foundation piece for us as Connection Christian Church. This isn't a part of what we do. This is who we are. Okay, our connections are to love God, to love people, and to love people enough to connect them back to God. And so it says in Matthew chapter 28, and this is Jesus talking, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to Me. First thing I'll point out to you guys is this. The authority that you have to build God's church, to make disciples, isn't from Mike. It's not from connection. It's from Jesus Himself. This was an important thing, and important enough that Jesus was uttering these with His last breath to His disciples before dying. Go and make disciples. You would think that there would be some weight to the final words of this man, this God, man on earth, as He's leading His disciples, His students. And I want to tell you that you are commissioned. Not the pastor, not the staff. You, the church, are commissioned as a disciple, as a student of Jesus, with His authority to go and make disciples. You can actually dig a little bit deeper into the Greek, and it kind of seems to indicate that as you go, so regardless of whether you're going to work or you're going to play or you're going to help a neighbor, as you go, whatever God has set before you, do it. But make disciples along the way. Why? Because you're connected with God, you love Him, and you love other people, you're connected with them, but you love them enough to connect them back to God. At least I hope you do. So we have His authority to make disciples, and here's how they identify themselves, by baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Guys, this is what we do over here in this stock tank. I mean, it's got a glorified purpose, and yet you can pick one up at any Farm and Fleet type of store around, right? We're not baptizing people in vain. We're not baptizing them so that they can continue to live a life that they've always lived. We're actually baptizing them so that they can identify more closely with Christ, so that they can understand what it means to die to the old way of life and to be able to live a new life created in the image of Jesus. And for the early church, this meant that you could easily be crucified, tortured, lose your life in a number of different ways just for identifying as a follower of Jesus Christ. And so that was one of the commands to baptize. Another is this: teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you. Now this gets a little strange, because we just said that all of the law was summarized in this, that we love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. If all I have to do is have this lovey-lovey feeling with God, why do I have to obey His commands? That gets a little far out there. Like, I just want to love people. I want to embrace what they're doing. I don't care what kind of thing that they're pursuing after, but they just need to know that I love them and God loves them. And so we start singing, "Jesus loves you, this I know." But the command is so much more than that. It's to identify as a Christian. And for you and I, the ones who already do, our mission is to teach them about Jesus. Here's another way it's said. John chapter 14. In John chapter 14, John was also a disciple of Jesus. Verse 15. Page 586, if you're having trouble finding it there. "If you love me, you will keep my commandments." This is Jesus talking. This isn't somebody fabricating something. This is Jesus talking to his followers. "If you love me," okay, "love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength," I got that part, "then you will obey." And it doesn't say that if we obey Jesus, he's going to love us. No. If we flip the paradigm, we've got things mixed up. Jesus already loves us. God already loves us and gave his son, his only son, Jesus, to die for us. But if we love him, then we will naturally obey the commands. Now, when I say naturally, it should come automatic, but it's a fight. We know that because we're pretty enrooted into the world. It's like we've got some pretty good ruts of past life and past experiences that we're trying to get out of. But the reality is that you cannot love Jesus without following his commands. And so as we learn to connect with God and to connect with others, and we want to strive to connect them with God, we have to remember to teach them. People don't automatically realize this because the world is teaching us a lot of messed up stuff. But the truth of the scripture is pretty fundamental. Now, this could be viewed as some slick marketing campaign. Matter of fact, people are trying to market the church all the time. We do some marketing around here. It's an important thing. We want people to know about Jesus. But we need to understand that there is kind of a secret to this mess, and that's love. We love God. We love others. So it's not like we're just trying to build a church. We're not trying to attain numbers. If we could be a church of 500 people, that's awesome. But if we're 500 people without God, what have we accomplished? Right? We love God enough that we want to be passionate for him. We want to align with wherever his wind is blowing, but we want to love people because God loves people and because God made us to love people. And when we share about God, when we share about Jesus or the church, we want to connect these people to Jesus and to God, not because of things that we've done or attaining numbers, but because their life can be better with Jesus. And their afterlife is going to be a whole lot better with Jesus. So we want to be passionate in doing so. And so as we make disciples, we need to understand it's under the authority of Jesus. We need to understand that it's his commands, not ours, not the world's, that people need to follow and to be taught. And it's also under his power. He says, "And I will be with you always and to the very end of the age." We look at the next verse in John chapter 14. It says in verse 16, "And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it has neither seen him nor knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. Yes, we're talking about the Holy Spirit of God. When Jesus is uttering these words and he knows he's about to die, he's going to come back and he's going to appear to his followers. But eventually, he's going to be taken up back to be with God. But he's not leaving us alone. He's leaving us with the power of God, the Spirit of God, living in those of us who believe and call upon his name. And so the power to stand up against the things that were weak, the power to love people that annoy the heck out of us, right? The power to connect in more ways than we can fathom. The power to get out of the old ruts of life and to move on. This is God in us. And so when we are asking you, let me check that. When Jesus is telling you to go and make disciples, you need to understand that it's his authority, that it's his commands, and it's his power to do so. Now, speaking of power, we probably all know what extension cords are. You can take this amazing extension cord, plug it into a source of power, whether that be a generator or an outlet, and you can run it across the room or across the lawn, and you can plug something into the other end, and it's like an extension of that power. And this is what you and I are supposed to do. We connect at one end to God. We connect at the other end to somebody else, to other people. And it's almost as though we're like supposed to be carrying out 220 power, you know, enough to power that dryer downstairs or that oven upstairs, you know, that big source of heat. And people are expecting great things, but you and I, that connection with God is kind of suffering a little bit. Our desire to love other people is kind of hit and miss at times. And so what's supposed to be all-out power is about 4 watts, enough to plug in a nightlight. Right? And that's the light that people see sometimes in us. We're supposed to make disciples, and we say, oh, this little light of mine, it's a nightlight, guys. Right? It's the power and the authority of Jesus that's supposed to be coming through. And the only way that people are going to get that full power and that full authority is if we're connected with God. Because if this connection's missing, we're not connecting with them with the full power of God. It's going to be hit and miss. In Matthew chapter 4, we see Jesus calling his first disciples. So this wasn't an afterthought that he had, go and make disciples. This was the initial process. Matter of fact, it was a process that the Jewish leaders would use. They would develop these teachers called rabbis. And the students, disciples, would come after them, not just to learn from them by oracle, by spoken word, but to actually see what they're doing, to experience what they're experiencing, to walk where they've walked, and to just absorb everything. And so Jesus, he knew that. And so he calls these 12 imperfect guys to come follow him, so that they can learn not how to be a disciple, but how to make disciples. So Matthew chapter 4, page 524, verse 19. And walking by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, his brother. They were casting nets into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Immediately, they left their nets and they followed him. Guys, I want you to see what's taking place here. Okay, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. I've said it before and I'll say it again because this may be the first time that some of you are hearing that. Jesus didn't say, come follow me and we're going to build a church. He didn't say, hey, come follow me, we're going to fill some chairs. He didn't say, hey, come follow me and watch me work. There was something more at stake. Jesus, from the beginning, didn't set out to make disciples. He set out to make disciple makers. He set out to unleash a movement. Guys, when we came here to start Connection Christian Church, we didn't come here to fill a church building. We didn't come here to train up a few disciples. We came here to call disciple makers who are going to unleash a movement across the community and to join with others who are doing the same thing. Guys, that is the church, disciples set apart from the world and unleashed on the mission of Jesus. And the only way that we get the full power and authority of that is to connect with God and to connect with his people. And it's got to be in love. It's got to be in love. Listen to this. So the disciples, if we just look at this passage here in Matthew chapter 4, number one is they follow Jesus. Remember, you can't love him without obeying his commandments. Like, you can't call yourself a Christian if you're not going to follow Christ. If you have no desire to do that, I don't know what you're up to. Maybe God is still working and he's laying the foundation and he's still working on drawing you near. And man, I'm so glad that you're here to be drawn near. But don't profess to be a Christian if you're not out there trying to share about Christ and trying to live Christ. Other people need that. You've probably heard it before that we may be the only Bible that some people ever read. We may be the only Jesus that some people ever see. And I hope they get 220. But I know in my life, there's a lot of things that prevent other people from getting the full power of Jesus. I'm so thankful that he works despite my flaws and failures. I'll tell you, he'll work despite yours too. Disciples make disciples. I will make you fishers of men. Disciples leave their past behind. After this statement, it says that the disciples, Peter and Andrew, they immediately left their nets and they followed him. That wasn't just putting down their nets. They weren't having an afternoon fishing party. Because this was their life. This was their livelihood. So their business was left behind because for the next few years they were going to follow after this man and learn from him. And maybe Jesus is going to call you at some point to leave everything that you've known so that you can passionately pursue after him. But even if he's not, I guarantee you that across the board, everyone in this room, if you're passionate about connecting with God, he is going to ask you to leave your past behind and to focus on a future with him. To focus on connections that are so much more valuable than anything you've experienced in the past. All of the flaws, all of the mistakes, all of the horrendous hurts. He's going to ask you to leave those things behind because his love for you is greater than all of those things. And his love for the rest of the people, he's going to want to drive you to connect with other people so that they can experience his love in great power. At my grandparents' house, they had a well outside and they had one of these pumps. I remember that as a kid. Now, we had indoor plumbing, so don't get me wrong there. It wasn't that bad. But we would use one of these to water the garden, the flowers, and things like that. And so, and as kids, we would often play with it. We'd just go out there and just crank on the thing, see how fast we could get it moving. And we'd stick our head under there or somebody else's head under there and had a great time with that. But I want to share with you that whatever is at the bottom, and you would run a pole, a pipe down into the well, and it creates a vacuum, and it sucks that water up, and so it comes out the spigot. Same thing happens in our houses today. It's just a little bit different technology. We use a sump pump here to pump out the baptistry, you know, when we're done there, and it just sucks the water up and shoots it out the garden hose, and wherever we point the hose is where the water goes. But no matter how you do it, no matter which type of pump that you use, here's a fact. You're only going to pump out the spigot whatever's in the well. You following? If you're not connected with God, this is what you're giving people. If you're not loving other people with a genuine love for Christ, that's what you're giving people. So Jesus says, you know, hey, I am the living water. Pure, undefiled water, right? Now, this is probably not quite so pure. This is out of the city tap. But it's still good for drinking. I would have no problem, other than the germs I just put in there, of passing this around and saying, hey, drink. This is good. This will rehydrate you. This will replenish you. This will give you the nourishment that you're looking for right now. But the reality is that many times, what's coming out of the spigot, not quite so tempting to drink. I know it probably looks like tea, and if you're into sweet tea like I am, man, this could be good. Also, it looks kind of like dirty fryer oil. That's not so good. But I want you to ask this question. What kind of Jesus are people seeing in your life? If you're the only Bible they read, if you're the only Jesus they see, what's coming out of your life? See, when we don't pursue after the commands of God and to obey God, because that's what we do when we love Him, then we're leaving a lot of things up to question. People aren't seeing God as He's meant to be and God as He is. They're seeing God as we have reconstructed Him to be. They're seeing a lovey-dovey kind of God that doesn't care if you follow His commandments or how much you mess up. Right? They're seeing a God that maybe you have put into action because you've been hurt by a parent. And you hear that God is supposed to be like your father and you're like, yeah, this is messed up. Or maybe you've had somebody in authority that's hurt you. They've taken advantage of you, and that's the kind of God that you have in place. And so when other people come around you, that's the kind of God that they see. Yes, God can still use that. He does every moment of every day. He takes our messes and creates something amazing. But we have to be passionately pursuing after God. And that's number one. I can sit here and tell you till I'm blue in the face, guys, connect with God, connect with other people, and connect other people to God. But if you're not connecting with God, number one, the connection at number two is of ill importance. And three is out of the picture. There are so many people that need to know the love and the power of Jesus. So what are other people learning about in your life? I want to share with you about a few things coming up. One of those things is something that we've just had ongoing. It's called One Focus. And so we've just simply said this. Who is that one person that God is asking you to connect with in your life? Who's that one person that you can be in prayer for? Who's that one person that you can serve, you can go out of your way for? Who's that one person that you can invite and encourage? Who's that one person? Not 10 people, not 20 people. Who's the one person that God is asking you to seek and to serve? And what are you going to do about that to connect them with the living water of Jesus? What are you going to do to make sure you're filtering properly? Another thing is this. Football Sunday, I said it before, in a couple weeks, it's going to be a great opportunity to invite people in. And I want to encourage you to do so. Invite people in. Maybe they don't want to know about church or Jesus at all. But maybe they're willing to come and hear some stories from some football players. Maybe they want to come in and have some crazy nachos. Maybe they want to come back and watch a football game on a big screen. Whatever the case, guys, it's not about football, it's about Jesus. And it may be the first opportunity we have to have that connection where we can share that information. And then, believe it or not, in April is Easter. We just got through with Christmas, and already we're turning the corner. So for the last 2 years, we've done these Easter egg hunts. And I've served some churches that are like, no, we're not going to have Easter egg hunts, and we're definitely not going to call them that. We just call it like it is. It's an Easter egg hunt. But it's also a great opportunity to connect with people, connect with community people. Over the last 2 years, we've done it in between two services, and it's been crazy. I know it's stretched people to nth degrees just trying to make sure everything happens, but we did that strategically so that people who weren't going to church on Sunday, on Easter Sunday, would be the ones that came in. Well, we don't have that option right now. We don't have green space out here. We want you to still have some place to park. Okay? So what are we going to do about that? Well, we're still trying to dream this up, but there's some things that have been put in motion. Number one is it's going to be the Saturday before Easter. So that alone may amplify the number of people that come. Okay? And they may be church people that are coming. And that's okay. Okay? We're going to serve them. We're going to love them, regardless of the situation. Another thing that we're going to do is last year we gave out over 5,000 eggs. I think we ended up with like 8,000 eggs that we stuffed. It was crazy. And we found more that we forgot about last year. So we have like 10,000 eggs in storage. And you know how long it's going to take us to stuff 10,000 eggs? It's going to take a while. And so I'm going to ask you guys to love our community and do it in service. And so that may mean that as you're sitting around in the evening watching your favorite show, you've got a bucket of eggs and some candy. Okay, it may mean that when you go to your small group, as you're talking about Jesus, you're stuffing some eggs, right? It may mean that you're dreaming about eggs, like all the time, right? You wake up in the morning and you're like, scrambled or fried? Either way, they're going down, right? So whatever the case might be, maybe it's every time you go to the store, you're picking up a bag of candy. Maybe you're even praying over these eggs as you're stuffing them. Maybe you're praying over that candy as you're purchasing it. And you're asking God to use this in amazing ways. Now, let me tell you something else that's crazy about this. I called Husker Chopper and said, hey, we'd like to do an egg hunt, but this time we want to just drop them from the chopper. And they agreed to do that for us. So we're going to be dropping 10,000 eggs someplace in Columbus. We're still working out the details on this. Okay, so I need to let you know, number one, Saturday could be a bigger crowd. The idea that we're throwing these eggs out of a chopper and nobody knows exactly what's going to happen, that's going to draw some people. But what we need is a lot of people on hand. And so we've got a piece of paper out on the connections table. And if you're interested in helping with this egg hunt, we need you to put your name down. Now, what that may mean is I'm going to buy some candy. That may mean I'm going to stuff some eggs. It may mean that I'm running security, so not everybody's running out there in the midst of the helicopter while it's doing its business. It may mean that you're getting on a phone or sending out some emails afterwards because we want them to know that Connection Christian Church did this because we love Jesus. I hope that we can be an agent of change in this community where people can see God at work. Last year, we had over 270 people gathered on Sunday morning for services. We had over 500 people gathered for an egg hunt. I mean, we walked out after first service and went, whoa, there's a lot of people here, right? And it's going to be crazy. But I need you guys to be passionate for Jesus and to be passionate for his mission. And I want you to pump out that living water like crazy. I think we can do some great things. So what's your next step? Maybe it's plug into a small group. Maybe it's get here on a regular basis. Maybe it's serve at an Easter egg hunt or invite somebody to a Super Bowl party. Maybe it's just to talk to someone else and to stop trying to do life alone. We were meant for so much more. Father, we thank you so much for connecting with us by sending Jesus, but also for giving us the ability to connect with you. These commands that you've given, I know that it can be cumbersome, but I also know that you're not meaning for it to come across that way. You're actually trying to give us a more full life. You're trying to prevent some bad stuff from happening. You're trying to allow your love to flow through us as though we're the conduit of your power. Father, help us to seek out your living water, and help us to share and to love out of the overflow of our hearts so that we can connect with you, connect with others, and connect others to you. Give us a passion for your mission. As these outreach opportunities, Father, help us to humble ourselves so that we can become less, and it's not about us, it's not about how much we grow, it's how much others grow in you. Help us to see the things that need to be tended to. Help us to see the struggles and the complications so that we can work through them. Help us to hit the timeout button and focus on some things that are maybe a little bit more important. And if there's something hindering these connections, Father, just break down these walls. Help us to bust out of our complacency and isolation, that we can celebrate how much you have cared, Father, that we can get out of the box and start building some crazy cool stuff.